So every day we do Sid skates before practice, after practice, and then he'll go out for warm-ups tonight and he'll keep them on, and after the first and second period he'll come in here and we'll resharpen these. He likes a fresh set of steel every time he hits the ice, which is not a problem at all. So that's why we have all this. So we're gonna just sharpen him up. I do 5 passes, but if there's a trauma on the blade, it might take a little bit longer because I'll have to work that out. But normally, since I'm sharpening every day, we don't have that major problems. So I've done 2, and if I do 5 on this skate, I'm gonna do 5 on that skate. If I do 6 or 6, I always keep his steel the same. So in my head, I always have to count. So there's 3, 4, 5, and I'm gonna take it off, but I'm gonna clean this. I'm gonna use a little of this.
What is that?
This is just a little oil. When I do my last pass, that stone is made of sand and glass, so it's cutting the steel from the blade. So my last pass, I'm gonna go a little bit slower, so that glaze is gonna help prevent burning of the blade. So I'm gonna do a real nice finish pass. And that's it. And I'd come in here and take the burr off. And that's a 1/2 inch hollow on Sid skates that has some nice bite angle, and he also has the ability to have nice glide.
Is his blade the same as everybody else's blades, or are they all different?
Every player on our team has a different profile or balance, and I work individually with each player to determine what the best numbers or best amount of blade on the ice is for them, and we work together on that. Sid is just sort of a neutral position, but we shave his toes a little bit. He's a little pitch forward, and because we sharpen Sid's skates so often, we're changing his steel about every 2 weeks. So he's always on fresh steel. And it's nice that we've been together for so long. Every time I sharpen it, now I can go to him and say, hey, Sid, I think we're ready to change, instead of him coming to me. It helps, you know, being with these guys for a long time. But it's pretty amazing if you think about it. The amount of blade that's really on the ice at one time is a very small amount of blade, even though you see all this. These guys are really skilled at what they do and are able to move around that ice surface on these blades. It's quite amazing.
That looks like a winning edge to you, huh?
I hope so. It better be.
Oh, okay.
There's a diamond on here.
Okay.
And it's cutting this stone.
As it goes. Oh, okay.
And I can predetermine the hollow that is going to go on the bottom of this blade.
Okay.
So we used to have Sid very deep, because that's how always he came from Rimouski that way. That's always how he was. And during the lockout, actually, I don't know if I should credit Matt Cook, but he somehow got him to try 5/8, which is a huge jump, very dramatic jump. And now we have him at 1/2 inch, which is kind of in between that, which is, you know, I'm happy for, because the deeper the hollow, people think that you're not going to have the same bite angle.
Mm-hmm.
You can have a shallower hollow and still have the right bite angle, but at a deeper hollow, there's more blade going into the ice.
Oh,
so
okay.
If there's more blade going into the ice, that is it's slowing them down. I mean, and you have to think about how powerful these guys are, but they're going to get tired. You know, they're working harder because there's more blade in the ice than the glide. You know, so little things that we can do to help educate them, to try to make them better, you know, I think is
That's
important
cool.
too. So we're always communicating with the players. If Sid said that he wanted to say at a certain hollow, or James Neal or whoever, I'm not going to argue with them. Yeah. I can put my two cents in and let them know, hey, this might be better. But if they're comfortable with something, it's not my job to change it. It's only to help them. So there's a lot to skate sharpen, and I know that myself and Paul DeFazio take a lot of pride in when we sharpen. So it's pretty cool.
That's neat. It's a lot of blades to sharpen.
Well, and just I'll show you. This is real funny. This is just from last year. This is all my steel that I change.
That one big bucket.
This bucket.
How long will you keep all that steel?
I don't know. That's just from last year. So.
So those are old blades from last year?
Yeah, let me pull something out and show you. So for instance, when I change steel on these guys' skates, here is this is Evgeny Malkin, this is a right blade, 4/5/12. That's the day that I took it off. Okay. And it says last game at Boston. This is one from 12/12/10, number 71. I don't know why that was in there. Here's a 12/27/10, duper. But this whole, every blade is marked in this bin of the day that was taken off. And then I put a / to indicate if I find another pair in there, that would be the one before that.
Now, what do you learn from keeping those blades?
I think this consistency of changing, and I can get a read on players. Like, if you look at this steel, this is kind of shame on me for letting a player get their steel that low. Mm-hmm. But at the same time, the player didn't want to change. I wanted him to change, but he didn't want to change. And
did he get superstitious about the steel?
I think they're absolutely they're comfortable, and but more can go wrong when steel gets this low. Mm. So there are some tense moments on the bench as an equipment manager watching a player out there when his steel is this low, because you've got to remember the odds of it maybe snapping or breaking, or you know, now his hollow. And his balance could be different, because as I keep sharpening, it's going to change a little bit.
Emergency scenario, blade snaps.
We got that covered.
How quick can you have a guy back on the ice?
It's funny you ask that question, because this is another situation that happened last year. This is a holder off of Sid's skates last year, and this is from the playoffs. Mm. And what happened was, again, he gets his skate sharpened between each period. So after the first period, he brought his skates in here, so I put it on the jig and I'm getting ready to sharpen. I see this, I'm like, oh my goodness. So we go into emergency mode. So this blade had to come off the bottom of his skate. It would have looked like this. So I had to remove all these rivets and copper rivets, take his blade off, remove his steel, and put it into a fresh holder, and then remount it and sharpen it. So what happened was, right here, this happened on 4/11/12, game one against Philadelphia, the first period. It took me 5 minutes and 37 seconds to change that. And if you look on this side, I wrote on there very proudly, didn't miss a shift. So that does happen. That does happen. And I think, after 25 years in this, it's important to stay calm and be confident in what you do. And this happens, hey, that's Sidney Crosby, or it could be anyone else. No. It doesn't matter. You have to stay calm, and you have to get that player back on the ice. And that's what they rely on us to do. And I'm really proud of that one.
Very cool.
You know what the layperson's thinking? I'm the layperson. Doesn't he have a second pair of skates?
Yes, we do. Yes, we do.
Oh, yeah.
Wouldn't that be easier?
No, it is. And let me just see. I do. Here. Okay, so this could happen. This is James Neal. Here's one part of it. So this snapped at home last year. So what we did is, in the back, every player has a second set of skates, and it's the skates that they wore prior to the ones they're wearing now. And that is now considered their backups. So if there's a major problem, some players just really don't ever want to wear their backups, but if they had to, they're with us everywhere. When we go to Philadelphia, we'll have them. When we go to New York, we'll have them. Everywhere we go, the backups, if we never use them, that's great. But they're always with us because we can't have guys missing shifts. Mm-hmm. And if I have to repair something, it might take me longer. One of the other equipment managers will grab that backup pair for that player, and he'll put him on his feet. He'll go play a shift or two, and I'll repair what I can and then get it right back on his feet. Mm-hmm. So, I mean, that's a situation that happens a lot, too. We've had some zingers. There's no doubt. We were in Winnipeg and we couldn't get Matt Kun or Chris Kunitz's blade off his skate, and we had a problem with James Neal as well a couple times. So these guys are lucky that we're organized and have everything for them, and that's part of our job. So it happens. Got to be prepared for it.
Very interesting. Very interesting.
Yeah.
Thank you very much.
Thought it was a backup pair being right.
Yeah, no.
That would be the last one. I guess that way you know that fits their foot, it's comfortable.
Well, and sometimes they're just so beat up or beat down. And here, this, again, look there, this just happened yesterday at practice. Look, you see a trend hitting here?
Is that a pocket?
Seems like
or
that
what is
plastic
it?
Look at that.
Working real well.
Look at that. That's from yesterday. That's Sid's.
So is that? Do you think that's him flexing that, or is it a puck hit?
I don't know. That's why I save all this stuff, because I'll address it with Reebok, but it could be any other company as well. These things happen. But Sid's so aggressive out there. I mean, he works the puck off his skate blade, mm-hmm. not only a stick, and he's blocking it with his foot. So you can see a puck hit here, but it did shatter it. Huh. So it's almost identical. And then you'll see over here too. Look at this crack.
Oh,
so
geez.
So he took some major trauma on that.
Yeah.
I don't know what it was, but he came off the ice and said, "Hey, something's wrong with my skate." I was like, "Yeah, there is. You can't skate on that."
How difficult a transition has it been, or has it been difficult, going from there's lockout, you're just kind of waiting, to all right, you've got a week, the season starts. How has that been?
Well, actually, surprisingly, it's been very seamless, and we're very fortunate because before the lockout started, we were had interaction with the players. We were working with them for about a week. Then the lockout happened, and we weren't able to have any contact to them. Unfortunately, it went a little bit longer than we hoped, but during the lockout, we were preparing the whole time mm-hmm. for hockey to come back. So when these guys came in the other day, it was like we just never lost a step.
When you go to Philadelphia and you're getting ready to pack everything up, what is that process like on Friday? Because you're going through the camp, you're going through practice
sure.
to get that whole process done seamlessly as you go from Friday here in Pittsburgh to Saturday in Philly.
Well, I think we're lucky, first off, because we still have the same staff that we've had for 7 years. And for us, it's old hat. So we've already prepared our trunks during the lockout, ready, knowing that hockey would come back and that we would be playing on the road. So now all we have to do is, with the current roster, make sure that we have all those little things that we didn't have for the players that have been added. You know, the Jason Magnas and the Bo Bennett and the kids that were in Wilkes-Barre that were called up. So we had to make sure we have all their stuff. But other than that, all our trunks are packed from last season and redone, ready to rock and roll, and we're ready to go to Philly. So now we're just waiting for Friday to get here, have a little skate here, and then we're going to hit the road.
Now, I have to ask, just out of curiosity, I don't want to put you on the spot, but did any skates that were being used during the lockout just all of a sudden appear on your doorstep with a note, could you sharpened?
Maybe. Maybe once or twice or three or four times.
Yeah.
I think, unfortunately, there's rules in place,
mm-hmm.
and the players understood the rules, and definitely the staff understood mm-hmm. the rules. I think, we really lived by those rules 100%, and there might have been a couple situations. At the end of the day, I think Ray Shiro put it best, it wasn't our fault, as trainers. But we do have a relationship with these players, and when you've worked closely with them, and most of these guys I've been with for 7 years now, and you have them so dialed in, I think it's important to keep, what we're doing with them the same.
Mm-hmm.
And during the lockout, Matt Cook stepped up and actually had a portable skate sharpener and was working on skates. But there was a couple instances that, he wasn't able to do something, and we had a gentleman Jason Binney working with them full time, and I would work with him via the phone and help him make sure that what the player needed was done by him, and I helped him along that process.
You were like the surgeon talking to the other surgeon.
Yes.
If we're going to take the gallbladder out, let's do this.
Sure.
That's tremendous. How excited are you to have Friday arrive, to finally, pack it up for real, ready to go? Because as competitive as these guys are, you guys are the same way.
Sure. I mean, we're ready to go. It was a disappointing finish for the season last year, and, our summer was a little bit longer than the Penguins are used to. But when the lockout hit, I think it was a nice time to be able to spend a little more time with family, and especially my wife appreciated that. But, and at the end of the day, I'm an equipment manager, and this is what's in my blood. And to work and spend the hours doing this, the sacrifices that, that my family makes for me to do this, it was a little bittersweet. It was nice. But at the end of the day, she understands this is what I do. But, I'm excited to be back, and I know the rest of the staff is to get back. So, it was important for hockey to come back. It was in a good place before, and now hopefully it'll be even better.
Last question. How many trunks will you guys pack on the plane or in the truck, or how are you going to get it there?
We are not the heaviest team in the National Hockey League, but we are a heavier team, per se. And with equipment, video, and medical, we probably have 16 trunks. For hockey, that might sound like a lot. That's nothing for like football. But at the end of the day, I always tell the visiting team when we're rolling in there, hey, listen, I'm the guy along with Paul DeFazio and Danny Crow who are packing this stuff up. We wouldn't be bringing it if we didn't need it. So we are a little bit heavy. We have extra bags as well. But at the end of the day, I don't want to have to go over on Saturday to the Philadelphia Flyers. Not that they wouldn't be, giving of whatever we need, but I don't want to have to ask for anything. We want to make sure we have everything we possibly need, so we take pride in that.
I know you guys put up a lot of stuff on the walls, and you make it try to look like the locker room back here. Any new messages going up? Can you let us in on a secret message that may go up this year?
That's going to come from the coach, and there will be probably one or two new secret messages up there, but he hasn't talked to the team yet to go over that. So once coach gives that to me, there'll definitely be a couple new ones up there. But we're ready. The signed trunk is packed, and it's ready to go.